Hello, everyone. welcome to the joint event by ICSID and the Japan Association of Arbitrators Investment Treaty Arbitration Committee on introduction to investment mediation. My name is Hiroki Tezuka. I'm an executive director of the JAA ITAC. I'm very glad and honored to make a brief introductory remarks at the beginning of this webinar, which I understand to be ICSID's first ever event in Asia focused on investment mediation. JAA was established at around the time when Japan introduced the arbitral model law in 2003 and to promote the arbitration in Japan, and its investment treaty arbitration committee was established around 10 years ago to promote investment arbitration in Japan. And Japan is now making its legislative efforts to adopt the 2006 version of the arbitral model law. And it is also considering introducing the enforceability of a mediation settlement agreement, which would be consistent with the Singapore Mediation Convention. And JAA has been actively supporting such kind of legislative efforts. So this is a very timely event where increasing interest can be seen on investment mediation. And I hope that you will enjoy and learn a lot from this webinar. Thank you very much. And I'll give Lars Marker the floor to introduce the speakers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tezuka-sensei. Yeah, my name is Lars Marker. I'm a foreign law partner with Nishimura and Asahi in the dispute resolution department, and I focus on investment arbitration. And it's my great pleasure to introduce the two speakers today. We'll start with Frauke Nitschke. And you can see I can pronounce her name correctly because I'm a compatriot. But more importantly, she's a senior counsel at the International Center for Settlement of Investment Disputes, ICSID. You'll hear that a lot today. And she serves as a team lead for the ICSID staff handling English language cases, and also as a secretary for investment arbitration tribunals, conciliation committees, and ad hoc tribunals. But most importantly for today's purpose, Frauke leads ICSID's investor state mediation efforts and activities, which includes the drafting of the proposed mediation rules and amendments to ICSID's conciliation framework. And in that role, ICSID, Frauke has conducted investment mediation skills trainings for government officials and mediators. Frauke herself is an accredited mediator. And as a lawyer admitted to the bars in DC and New York, she holds law degrees from Germany and the US. And most importantly, and maybe she can tell us later whether this is required for a good mediator, she holds a master's degree in psychology from a German university. So much for Frauke. And then we go on to Geraldine Fischer, who is a legal counsel in one of the case management teams with ICSID. And interesting for the people dialing in from Japan, she's been based in Tokyo since September 2020. She serves as a secretary to arbitral tribunals, conciliation, commissions and ad hoc committees in investor state proceedings. And even though she's far away from DC, she can do that. I hear now it's all virtual. And unfortunately for her, sometimes with large time differences, what I hear. Jerry has a very interesting background. Prior to joining ICSID, she worked as a senior research fellow at the Center for International Law at the National University of Singapore. And prior to that, she was an attorney with some of the US leading law firms in investor-state arbitration for a couple of years. And she began her legal career as an attorney for the Office of the Chief Counsel for International Commerce of the US Department of Commerce. She also is admitted to the DC and New York bars and holds law degrees from National University of Singapore and US universities. Now, so much for the introduction. The roles today will be divided in the sense that Frauke will provide us with the introduction to investor-state mediation, and Jerry will moderate the Q&A. Now, how are we going to do the Q&A? You will see in the bottom right corner of your WebEx screen, there is a little chat button. So if you come up with questions, feel free to type in questions to Frauke as they come up. And then Jerry will take a look, and if they are right on topic, she will actually just interrupt Frauke and make this as interactive as possible. Other questions that are more of a general nature, she will ask at the end, where we leave a couple of minutes for Q&A time. So with that organizational remark, and without further ado, on to Frauke.
Yeah, well, thank you, Lars. I'm very honored to be here, and thank you to the JAA and ITAC. And I'd like to offer a minasama ohayo gozaimasu, and I hope that expresses the good morning that I wish to all of you and to us together, and for you to join me as we speak about investment mediation, which is a topic dear to my heart, as my colleagues will tell you. I can speak about this often and a lot. And I'll take moments now for the next 30 to 40 minutes to address a couple of points here, starting out with what is ICSID? What is the background to ICSID's decision to propose to our member state investment mediation rules, the current developments on investment mediation that we're also involved in, looking at process, and here maybe a bit in detail, because for many of you who may practice mediation in Japan, you may see differences in terms of the process that we include in our mediation rules from what might be practiced domestically. When can ICSID mediation be used? And here we link in with the investment treaty arbitration committee. How does it, can you link the two processes, mediation and arbitration? What are ICSID's mediation activities? And what is it really, the bigger picture? We have mediation rules, but what are other considerations that we can keep in mind with the goal to really find an effective dispute settlement process for investment matters? So what is investor-state dispute settlement? This is basic. You will all be familiar with that. It's a system to resolve disputes related to investments involving a foreign investor and a state party. And the idea really is to find an impartial forum, a neutral forum, and depoliticize the angle that investment disputes with the host states by nature really have, that we put them on a different track. The processes that we know, this might be in investment arbitration, conciliation, we'll look a little bit at some differences, mediation, which will be the focus for us, or fact-finding that ICSID also offers. And how can parties access this investor-state dispute settlement? And that is based on what we call sources of consent. So agreements of the parties, they can crystallize in contracts, ad hoc agreements, or by an offer of a state in an investment treaty or investment law that it's then subsequently accepted by the investor. So where does ICSID fit in? We are part of the World Bank Group, one of the five member organizations established in 1966 by the ICSID Convention. And the goal was really, as I said, to create this multilateral international forum to assist mobilize large flows of cross-border investment. And interestingly, I spent some time when I worked on the conciliation rules to look at what is the history, what happened with the conciliation, what did the drafters have in mind? And in 1958, it was actually a dispute involving citizens of Tokyo who engaged the World Bank's president seeking assistance to assist with the resolution of an investment, what we would today, nowadays, call an investment dispute that would fall under the auspices of ICSID. And so I just think that's interesting. And Tokyo actually also became known as the No of Tokyo in ICSID history for the Latin American states who did not want to offer an additional means of solving investor-state disputes for foreigners. And so Japan has been, not only since its 1967 active member states, so you also have played a role in the evolution, especially Tokyo in that sense. So where are we today? ICSID has 155 contracting states. Mexico was the last to join, to ratify and deposit its instrument of ratification in 2020, and Djibouti joined 2 years before that. What is the structure of us as an institution? We have a governing body, that's the Administrative Council, and the ICSID Secretariat. And I am part of the Secretariat, I'm part of the staff. We have a Secretary General, McKinnear, and two Deputy Secretary Generals. Our job is primarily case administrations, and most of our cases are arbitrations. We also provide training and technical assistance and knowledge management activities. On the other hand, on the Administrative Council, as I said, as a governing body, is adoption of rules, approval of budget, annual report, election of our Secretary General, and designations to panels of arbitrators and conciliators, which are called upon in certain circumstances under the rules. Now, what do we offer? What are ICSID's dispute settlement services? I mentioned the ICSID Convention from 1966, and there the services provided are conciliation and arbitration, where both disputing parties have a link to an ICSID member state. In 1978, the Administrative Council expanded that offering so that only one, or in most known, for only one disputing party has a link to an ICSID member state. On the one hand, on the parties, the extension, and then not only conciliation and arbitration, but the addition of fact-finding mechanism. In green, you see the other services that ICSID offers, for example, case administration under other treaties, or rules, especially here the answer trial, arbitration rules or state-to-state cases, appointing authority, and mediation. We already offer assistance to ad hoc mediations where the parties consent for us to do that. Now, turning to the background of ICSID and ICSID's mediation rules, we proposed the mediation rules initially to our contracting states in 2018 with our first working paper. I should add here the mediation rules have not yet been adopted. We are currently drafting the hopefully final working paper number 5. We hope that with the COVID situation, we will soon have them adopted. So this gives you a bit of the background of what was the trend in 2018. And we had seen over the past decade mediation mentioned in treaties. So our member states use the reference to mediation alongside conciliation and arbitration. So there was an indicator that they understood there was a different process and perhaps a different process that was needed. And we had member states who specifically asked us to offer mediation services to serve as a trusted, credible international forum that could offer this type of process. In 2016, over one third of ICSID member states adopted the guide on investment mediation that was prepared by the Energy Charter Secretariat and then adopted by the conference, which is a very practical document providing practical insights into mediation, how to prepare, what to consider. So whoever is really interested in investment mediation and would like some practical guidance, I recommend looking at that document, and ICSID was certainly involved in that development. Now, in 2018, we had the multilateral work on the Singapore Convention, and by now we have the entry into force this September. And as you know from the drafting history of the Singapore Convention, it was intended not to include the application of the convention also to investment disputes. 2018, then the model instrument on investment dispute management, also developed by the Energy Charter Secretariat, which provides guidance for states to develop a legal framework, a domestic legal framework, encouraging the use of mediation and providing certain aspects and ideas that states may consider when adopting legislation. And then, of course, the empirical data on outcomes in ICSID arbitration. And maybe here a little anecdote. When I first started at ICSID, I was a part of the institutional team, and I looked at statistics. I really like math, and I looked at what happened in ICSID cases. And when I looked at this data, over 33%, over one third of cases settled, I asked, so, you know, do you think arbitration is the right process if that is your outcome, that so many cases settle? And, well, the answer at that time was yes, but we evolve over time. And nowadays, we'll look at, do we have a different process that can assist us with settlements, and that will lead us to the ICSID mediation role. So what is it that we want to achieve with offering that kind of mechanism? We want to provide the states and the investors with this neutral and trusted forum to facilitate negotiations, and I will get back to that point. Offer disputing parties broad access to investment mediation facilities. We'll also look at that. Mediation, as you know, is a party-driven process. It's flexible and allows for customized solution in the hands of the parties. And we also wanted to offer a time and cost-effective dispute resolution process. And then last but not least, align the mediation with the formal requirements in Article 4 of the Singapore Convention for mediated for the enforcement of mediated settlements. So what is the nature of mediation? It's entirely voluntary. And here I want to underline the difference to what some of you may know about the ICSID arbitration system. There in arbitration, you cannot unilaterally withdraw a consent to ICSID arbitration. However, mediation is different in that you need the party agreement at the outset to commence the process, and then at any time during the mediation, a party may withdraw unilaterally, and that's what I call a sort of ongoing consent for the process. Differences to conciliation, I just want to touch upon here, because that is what we have in the convention and the additional facility rules, and just to highlight a few, that the scope is broader, and we'll look at it on the next slide. Conciliation has most of the time a three-member commission, and we don't have that in the mediation context. There are no preliminary objections to jurisdiction, as they are often referred to in the mediation, but the mediation begins pretty much immediately on that. Now, what is the scope that I've mentioned? And so what is in our proposed rules is to authorize the Secretariat to administer any mediation that relates to an investment, involves a state, or an REIO, which the parties consent in writing to submit to ICSID. So what you see here, it's a very broad access that doesn't, that is not linked to an ICSID membership requirement. It doesn't have the specification of foreign, that you need a foreign party or nationality. And so the cornerstone really is the consent in writing to submit to ICSID. Oops, hold on. Yeah. Hold on, let me see this. Here we have a short process overview just to give you an initial flavor, and we will look at these different aspects in the slides to come. So the process mirrors In general terms, in terms of the structure, the arbitration and conciliation that might be familiar to you, it starts out with a request for mediation, and then the decision by the Secretary General either to register or to refuse registration. Subsequently, the appointment of the mediator, and we'll look at that. In arbitration, we have one or three most of the time, so an uneven number. The mediation rules provide for one or two. Brief initial written statements by the parties, followed by a first session that determines the mediation protocol, which will then serve as the basis, which will serve as the basis on which the mediation is conducted. And then the termination of the mediation, the different aspects you have there in green. So how can a mediation at ICSID commence? And here there's a new element, which is that we also include a mediation that can start by an offer, a request for mediation that includes an offer by one party to mediate that the secretariat then transfers to the other party, inviting that party to state whether it accepts that offer. And that party is free to choose whether it wishes to accept or whether it does not wish to participate in the mediation, and then the process would not continue. And the more well-known route is the pre-existing agreement to mediate, a clause in a contract, an ad hoc agreement, or a treaty requiring or offering mediation that is then accepted by the investor. Registration of the request, I already mentioned that. If the Secretary General is satisfied that on the basis of the information, the request is within that scope that we outlined in Mediation Rule 2. Let's move to some general procedural provisions now. First, starting on costs, not a surprise here that costs are shared equally by the parties and each party bears its own costs and expenses. But here the parties are certainly given the opportunity to agree otherwise if one party offers to cover the cost of the process, for example, that is, of course, a possibility under the rules. The mediation rules also include a provision on confidentiality that all information relating to the mediation and documents generated in or obtained during the mediation are confidential unless, of course, there's party agreement or the document is independently available. So per se, by use of the mediation, the confidentiality provision does not apply if the document is, for example, in the public domain or if disclosure is required by law. Now, for those of you familiar with ICSID conciliation, you know that in Article 35, there is a without prejudice provision enshrined in the ICSID Convention, and that is what we replicate in the mediation rules here, knowing that that was the intention of our member states. And that is that any position taken or admissions or offer of settlements made or views expressed by one party during the mediation is without prejudice on positions that that party may take in any other proceeding. And of course, that is subject to party agreement to the contrary. Now we're moving towards the mediator appointment and the qualifications of the mediator. So the rules have as a basic principle the impartiality and independence of the parties. And then parties may certainly agree that the mediator may have other qualifications or expertise that those parties consider relevant for their particular dispute and for the process they wish to design. On the mediation rules, as I mentioned earlier, the specification is that there are one or two co-mediators. This is nothing new in mediation, but it is new for our arbitration friends, that mediators are appointed by agreement of the parties. Under the ICSID rules, that is envisioned. And if the parties do not are unable to reach an agreement on that point, the default is one mediator. Should the parties not be able to agree on a mediator or appoint a mediator within 60 days after the registration of the request, either party may ask the Secretary General to appoint a mediator. And should the parties initiate the mediation, but there's no step that's being taken within 120 days, the mediation will be terminated. This is to avoid having a process hang where the parties have abandoned the pursuit of that. So once we have an appointment, how does the process look? And here, this is familiar for those investment treaty arbitration practitioners. The acceptance within 20 days provides a declaration of impartiality and independence with a continuing disclosure obligation. What we also have here is the mediator, the rule that the mediator may not act as arbitrator or conciliator or expert or witness or in any other capacity relating to this dispute unless the parties and the mediator agree otherwise.
Frauke, we have a question from the audience.
I love that. Thank you.
Can you see it? If there are two mediators, is there an allocation of roles? Example, is one the mediation expert and the other the investment claims expert?
Thank you for that question. Let's address that here. I think that's very important, and it relates to the role of the mediator that I will cover in a couple of slides. So under the ICSID rules, the role of the mediator is to assist the parties in finding a mutually acceptable resolution of the dispute. The question, what are the functions and should we have sort of a content expert and a process expert and should we pair the two? That came actually up in the discussions with the member states and especially in the November 2019 consultations when I presented the mediation rules. I was asked that question too, so I'm glad to have the opportunity to address it here. I think there is a general answer and a specific answer. And the general answer is that that mediation and the role under the ICSID mediation rules of the mediator are to navigate the process. So in that context, if we go to what would be the qualifications of a mediator, it's certainly mediation expertise. I would agree with the question asked that we need that. It's certainly helpful to understand government or the investment context, to understand the context in which the dispute takes place, from where the parties come from, how governments function. I think that is all helpful. My personal opinion is that if we needed an expert on investment arbitration, for example, or valuation, that is possible under the rules to appoint an expert that helps the mediator and the parties and assumes that role. Personally, I would be careful in mixing the role of the mediator with that of an expert within evaluation, but that again leads back to what is my understanding of mediation. And if we start out that the mediator is facilitative, then the expert can serve that expert role. If the parties, on the other hand, wish to have the mediator to provide evaluations or certain recommendations of settlement, then in those particular circumstances, perhaps the pairing of a mediator and an investment expert would be helpful, so long as it is clear that the mediator is in charge of the process and the expertise comes in when it's needed. That would be my view on that. Good.
I think that's great, a very thorough answer.
And we will touch upon in a couple of slides again. So if it's not clear, then please do, we can revisit this at the end of my slides.
Super.
Resignation and replacement. So here, this is a little bit different from what you may know on ICSID convention arbitration. If the parties jointly request the mediator to resign, the mediator shall do so. So there is a power of removal in that sense. And if you have a co-mediation and one of two co-mediators resigns, there is no requirement for the parties to appoint another co-mediator if they agree that we are satisfied with continuing with the one remaining mediator. So here I already spoke about that. What is it that we had in mind when we drafted? And this is where we come back to sort of perhaps a difference of mediation practiced as court annexed or as an evaluative process, the ICSID rules do not prescribe that. The role of the mediator is to assist the parties in reaching this mutually acceptable resolution of all or at least part of the issues in dispute. And the mediator obviously does not have the authority to impose a resolution, but the mediator also doesn't have by default the ability to recommend a settlement or to provide an evaluation. We'll look at the tools maybe in 4 or 5 slides. So if the parties agree for the mediator to assume that role, that is possible, but the default is what you may call facilitative. So what is the what are the duties of the mediator to conduct the mediation in good faith, in a cost-effective and expeditious manner, and treat parties equally and provide them with an equal opportunity to participate in the proceeding? What's the mirror of that? And that's the duty of the parties. That's to cooperate with the mediator and also with one another in the process. And the good faith qualification here is as well as the expeditious and cost-effective manner. This is this resonates also in the amendments proposed to the arbitration and the conciliation rules. So now what we have a mediator in place, the appointment has been accepted. The next step will be for the parties to submit a brief initial written statement describing the issues in dispute and the parties' views on these issues, so not a legal pleading in a technical sense, within 15 days after the mediator has accepted the appointment. And that will then be followed by the first session. And so a joint session between the mediator and the parties, where what we call the mediation protocol will be developed. So we'll look at procedural and administrative matters, languages, place of meetings, treatment of information that's confidential to the outside, for example, media protocols, development of agreed news releases, for example, and then also the treatment of information disclosed in caucus by one party to the mediator, division of payments or the advances requested to cover the cost of the proceedings, those things will be addressed, as well as any agreement between the parties on issues such as not to initiate or to suspend any other proceedings concerning the application of prescription or limitation periods, disclosure of information or settlement agreement resulting from the mediation that we left to the parties to be addressed in the first session. And importantly here, what we wanted to do is we wanted to link the process of mediation with the implementation and the conclusion and implementation of a settlement agreement as the outcome of the mediation. And to link that, the parties will be asked or are asked on the occasion of the first session to identify a representative who is authorized to settle the dispute and describe the process that would follow to conclude and implement the settlement, so that we know at the outset who needs to be involved in really getting a concluded settlement, and that may especially on complex corporate structures or on the other hand government entities will need to sign off. That is important to include in the process early on. So conduct of the process, I already mentioned that's the basis on the basis of the protocol, and the mediator has certain tools at his or her or their disposal. The mediator may meet or communicate with the parties jointly or separately, request additional statements or explanations, may make recommendations, and here I mentioned that in the ICSID rules, this needs a joint request of the parties, and the ability to seek expert advice with the agreement of the parties as well. Termination of the mediation is a notice from the parties that they have signed a settlement agreement, notice from the parties that they have agreed to terminate the mediation, or one party withdraws from the mediation in the course of the process, determination by the mediator that there is no likelihood of resolution, Or, as I mentioned earlier, there was no step that was taken to appoint the mediator within 120 days of the registration. And for those of you who are involved in commercial mediation, this is a little bit more formal, that we issue a written notice of termination. This is keeping in mind here, we aligned it with the requirements in Singapore, or for example, if mediation is perhaps a prerequisite of arbitration, that we have that written notice of termination in place, should that be needed. And that is a segment into when can ICSID mediation be used. And here the Investment Treaty Arbitration Committee will focus, for example, let's start with the treaty provisions. And that's what we've seen, mediation mentioned as part of a cooling off period. So after the notice of dispute, but before proceedings are instituted, that is where mediation can be a choice. There is an ongoing discussion whether mediation should be voluntary or mandatory, and that is something I think that is a policy decision that we will see across the globe decided differently, and certainly there are different arguments, pro and con. A mediation as an independent dispute settlement process, or as a standalone, not linked to arbitration, or a combination, and how could a combination look? As we mentioned, either as part of the cooling off, or maybe a full multi-tier, that mediation needs to be instituted before an arbitration can be commenced. Or, and to me personally, that might be a likely scenario, that we have a mediation with an ongoing ICSID arbitration, where the parties suspend the ICSID arbitration, pursue the mediation, and then if a full settlement is reached, the parties may agree to discontinue the arbitration. And should in settlement enforcement be needed, Singapore Convention could come into play. Or they could resume the arbitration and request the tribunal to embody the settlement in an award, and then benefit, if it's an ICSID convention scenario, from the simplified enforcement mechanism. On the other hand, if partial settlement is reached, parties may continue to arbitrate. Only the remaining issues in dispute and the benefits there might be arguably the time reduction and reduction in costs as well, when the decision that is required from the tribunal is limited. That leads me then to ICSID's more broader mediation activities. I've mentioned the ongoing consultations with our member states on the mediation rules, and with our aim to have them adopted as soon as possible. And I'm currently preparing the working paper 5 in response to or considering comments that we received from member states after the November 2019 consultations. I'm sorry, Working Paper 4 was issued in February 2020, so what we received after February 2020. And we already offer administrations of mediations that the parties wish to administer by ICSID. And then we have a number of capacity building activities. On the one hand, the investor state mediator training that we've been offering since 2017. In DC or Paris, and now we've conducted online just recently in December. We also paired up with the IFC, the Investment Climate Unit of the World Bank, to provide training for government officials on mediation skills to resolve investment disputes. Awareness raising really more generally, or technical assistance workshops on dispute prevention and effective management. And then within the reform discussion of the working group through 3, we work together with the UNCITRAL Secretariat and will be developing guidelines, practical guidelines for investment mediation, and look at mediation model clauses that we can offer to state parties to consider for adoption in their treaties or in their contracts. And here that was the interesting part, really, in the consultations. We had a longer discussion, really, within our member state consultations. How would a consent to exit mediation rules look, and what should states consider? And I'm really pleased that we will be offering these rules or model clauses that states can then put into their policy frameworks as they see fit. Now, that was specific to ICSID, the background of ICSID mediation rules, but let's put it a bit in context, and I wanted to take a moment to do that. And that is looking at mediation. Mediation is really an opportunity to maintain long-term relationships between the investor and the host state. And I think when we take a step back and we look at what is investment, an investment is intended for a longer period. It's not just a commercial transaction. And when you talk to companies, for example, like GE, that have really diversified investments across the globe, they are not necessarily a fan of investment arbitration, which my colleague, my dear colleague Roberto Echandi, describes as the divorce proceeding. And I think mediation offers that opportunity to continue that relationship and do perhaps some sort of marriage counseling to come out at the other end and to continue to work together for a common goal. Similarly, in recent years, the conversation has changed how important effective dispute management in the investment arena is to look at FDI, foreign direct investment retention and expansion. So there are calculations out there that every year over $1 billion US dollars are lost in investors simply abandoning their investment already made for lack of effective dispute management. And here I think there is a good opportunity to look at different processes that could help with that resolution that offers a new avenue really to what we've known. We looked at treaty developments, the ICSID mediation rules who fill out those references to mediation. The Singapore Convention, I think, was a really important development here. It has sort of a halo effect, in my view. And some of you may remember there was a survey in 2015, I believe, of large corporations around the world, and 82% said we would actually embark in mediation if there were an enforcement mechanism. So the Singapore Convention, I think, has a lot to do with encouraging parties to trust in that process and to participate. And I think that's what we certainly see in the discussions as well. Dispute prevention efforts here, the systemic invest response mechanism by our World Bank colleagues, I think that is a very important development as well. And here we've worked together with our colleagues, and I've recently done courses with Rwanda, with Jordan and Ethiopia on training on mediation and the idea of resolving investment disputes before they really get to the arbitration stage. And then perspective about the domestic legal framework. And that is, I'm very glad to see that the Working Group 3 discussions are broader, not only on mediation, but on dispute prevention and what is it that we need. And there's work that's going to be done on a model law on dispute prevention and addressing organizational aspects. Do we need a lead agency? Would that be helpful? Does it need to look the same way in every state? Are there different ways of doing it? Who would be in charge of engaging in mediation or signing off? And really implementing or legitimizing, if you will, the use of mediation by the state as a form of settlement of investment dispute. And then what I already mentioned, the Energy Charter Secretariat's model instrument that provides guidance on domestic and legal frameworks. And with that, let me try again. Yoro Chiko Onega Shima. Oh yeah, I hope that was the thank you or the Dankeschön, as we would say in German. And with that, I will stop sharing my slides and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Frauke, for your excellent overview of investor state mediation and ICSID's mediation activities. We'll now start the question and answer portion of our program, which I will be moderating. We want to encourage everyone to ask questions. Frauke has been working on these issues for many years, and she has some terrific insights, so we should take advantage of her presence here. So as a reminder, you can submit your questions to the panelists through the chat function, and I'll then relay your questions to Frauke. And I will not be attributing the question to the author of the question. Okay, so to give you a chance to send your questions, I'll get the ball rolling. Frauke, can you give us an idea of how many investment mediations there have been and whether they have been successful?
Yeah, thank you, Jerry. That is an excellent question on linking us to practice. It's a difficult question to answer, to be honest, because as we've seen in the ICSID mediation rules, the principle of confidentiality is valued, and that came out with our discussions with member states. So the information relating to investment mediations is not readily available. What we know certainly, and you will have seen it in the arbitration community, it was made public, is the recent Punta Catalina mediation involving the Dominican Republic that settled, I believe it was February or March this year, and was reported on. There was another mediation that was often talked about involving the Philippines. And I have talked to a number of really experienced mediators in the international context, and there are many more mediations out there than we actually know about, and certainly in the arbitration community. So while it's difficult to put a real number on it, it shouldn't be underestimated. I think that would be my answer. And from what I heard from the mediators with whom I spoke, the success rate that has been attributed was around 80%. I would add to that that I think in the Singapore University has done a few years ago studies research on obstacles to settlement. And I do think one of the aspects that came out today already when we talked earlier before the webinar started is the fear of taking the responsibility for state government officials. That was one thing that came out of that survey. On the other hand, I offer there that we know from the investment arbitration that over 30% settle, and so there is a possibility to get there. So to close that, the political aspect that may change, I think there is a question, if you and I would have talked in 2005, how many Argentine cases would settle, I think we wouldn't have come up with the reality of 2015, 16, 17, 18. And so I think there is a time and place where the mediation are most successful, and that's why I'm so excited about the work with the IFC. The earlier we catch it, I think the more likely it is that we find a settlement.
That's great. And I actually think Lars had a follow-up question. Lars, I don't know if you want to ask it or if you'd like me to ask it about the authorized person to settle. Okay.
Yeah, I can ask it. When I imagine mediation in a context where governments are involved, isn't one procedural obstacle the point where you have to designate a person authorized to settle very early on? I could imagine two types of governments. One type of government where basically there's an infight between different ministries and they say, well, we are in charge. Or I could imagine a different type of government where basically each ministry says, well, actually, we don't want to have anything to do with that when there's money flowing potentially. So how does that work?
And thank you for that process. That became clear to us in different translations of the mediation rules. As you know, we have them in French and Spanish. And there is a misunderstanding of that part, which is that you are not, the idea is not that you designate a person with authority. You do not vest someone with authority. You describe how would it work. and who would be authorized to settle, not authorize them, but to explain that process. And that is the interest, to me, the fascinating thing of investment mediation. And experienced commercial mediators will tell you that it's pretty much the same in the commercial context, that there will actually be at least two mediations. There will be the mediation between the investor and the state, and there will be the mediation going on between different government entities. And that is something that that will continue to be in the background. How does the settlement look, right? When you know the settlement, it shapes up, you may need the involvement of that agency, perhaps no longer this agency. That's why you do a stakeholder analysis early on. And that is where I go back to the importance of the legal framework on the domestic level, on the structural aspects. If you have a lead agency who can help with the internal coordination, the process between the investor and state will be easier. Yeah, I hope that answers that. Thank you for bringing that back up. That's I will highlight that.
So there are a few more questions. One is very practical. So how much are the mediators' fees and what would ICSID's charges be?
Yes. Thank you.
Whether or not it's based on the size of the claim.
We spent quite a long time discussing that. And I've done an analysis, a comparison across institution across the globe. It's not set in the rules yet. Not going to be, I think that is fair for me to say that it's not going to be linked to claims. It's also doesn't look like this would be an administrative fee on an annual basis, but it would be on time spent if we look at administrative fees. If you look at the mediator, the proposal that we make is that they will be remunerated similar to arbitrators. So the schedule of fees will then apply to the mediators as well. Good.
Great, that's very helpful. The next question is about mediator training events. Will ICSID be holding mediator training events in Japan or in East Asia in the future? Y'all want more Frauke.
Yeah, I would love. My husband always makes sure he gets his stuff over in Japan. And so I would love to come and have been working with James Flaxton in various mediation-related activities. And here we established that. So I think the future is bright. And what I can say is that since 2018, we have come every year to Hong Kong to deliver a mediator training there for government officials and experienced mediators that is open to everybody across the globe. And so in 2018, in December, we did our first virtual mediator training in a time zone that was conducive to Europe and North America. And we plan one for Asia in the late spring. So please visit ICSID's website and we will publish it. Once we have dates, we will publish it there.
Okay, great. So another question is about any thoughts that you would have on a mediator making comprehensive settlement recommendations, perhaps even splitting the difference between the two parties.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. And there, let me take a step back. So as I try to underline that the ICSID rules, and we discussed this when drafting the rules, and whether the rules should have the default of the possibility of settlement recommendations. I note here that in the ICSID conciliation rules, this power is vested in the commission to make the recommendations. We wanted to make a difference on the mediation, and we are very aware that the understanding of mediation in different regions of the world differs on that. In some countries, it's very clear that an evaluative version of mediation, where the mediator evaluates, or oftentimes it's a judge who is appointed, perhaps even makes a recommendation. And we wanted to leave that to the parties. If you prefer a facilitated negotiation or a recommendation. I personally would hesitate to a recommendation by the mediator, given what I heard the experiences. Splitting the difference may perhaps lead to disappointment for at least one party, if not both. And then where does the mediator go from there? And I've had a long conversation with a very experienced mediator who said he did it in one of his mediations, and the communications broke down. And so what he recommended, and that makes a lot of sense to me, is to, if recommendations are needed, maybe you appoint an expert, or you appoint somebody, or you bring in your lawyers, look at the role of your advisors in the process to get to the recommendations, so that the mediator then can take the process from that point onwards and engage in discussions with the party. So that's what you've heard. What do you think about that? Where do you want to take it from here? And separate from that, if there is a desire to get a recommendation, maybe then an early neutral evaluation process could be more suitable. I think the main point here is really to be clear, what do both parties want and what do they find most suitable? And if that is clear for everybody, then that is a good process.
I think that's very helpful. So I guess taking it back, so as a first step, how do you determine whether mediation is suitable to resolve an investment dispute?
That's a very good question. And I think the jury is still out there, and it may also be in the eyes of the beholder, what is suitable and what is not suitable. There might be different answers from different people. What I can do is I can offer maybe a couple of things people can keep in mind when assessing the suitability of mediation. And one is, if the parties would like to keep the control of the outcome, looking at understanding mediation here in a negotiation facilitation, that the parties want to shape the outcome rather than delegate the outcome to a third party, be it in the form of a recommendation or an arbitrator deciding the issues. The other thing is maybe costs. Cost of pursuing litigation, arbitration, versus what is it that you could potentially recover, and sort of a risk analysis. Maybe also to consider is where the speedy resolution of the dispute, is of utmost importance. One could think here in the COVID area, state measures, something that parties want to continue their investment marriage, to stay with that analogy, but need some counseling to get off the ground. And we know the economic challenges that are ahead. Maybe, as I mentioned before, the maintenance of the relationship. And here again, I refer to the diversified investments. I think for those, that makes a lot of sense, and the general counsels that I've spoken to that work in companies where the diversification in different sectors, they find mediation particularly attractive. Then, of course, keeping in mind sort of no deep hostilities between the parties. If it's all broken down, then mediation may not be the process for you. Or if a party wishes to seek interim relief, provisional measures, that is not what a mediator is empowered to do. So there, an arbitration tribunal might be better. Or in fact, really, a conciliation commission has a similar power to issue at least status quo recommendation. Or if parties seek non-monetary relief, I think that's an important aspect too. When you look at investment treaties, you know, what is it that you can get under those legal, for a breach of a legal norm or legal obligation? And perhaps also to consider if matters of fundamental principles are at stake. I continue to think about that, but I offer that as a consideration of whether mediation is something you wish to engage or not. And I would love to hear from the audience down the road. Please feel free to email me if you have other ideas. I think that will be an evolving subject.
I think that was a very thorough response. That was great. Okay, so there is another question. I think there was one question that I think you probably just covered it about the key advantages of investor state mediation. So we'll move on to the next one. And this will probably be our last one. Could you explain how the Singapore Mediation Convention would contribute to promoting investment arbitration?
Thank you for that question. And that allows me to clarify what I may not have been sufficiently clear. So what I wanted to say there is that in 2015, there was a survey that indicated that many big corporations were interested in engaging in mediation rather than arbitration, provided that there was some sort of security net, safety net, to go to enforcement. Let me engage in a process if I know that if somebody doesn't comply with the settlement, I can get an enforcement. And so the Singapore Convention filled that gap. Like the safety net will develop because you have that potential enforcement mechanism. To be clear, I do not think that the Singapore Convention will increase arbitration, because if you have a settlement in arbitration, you will enforce that under ICSID Convention or New York Convention potentially. And so one thing I wanted to offer there is that from the ICSID experience, where you have discontinued cases where parties settled but chose not to incorporate that in an award, I think out of about 258 cases, something like that, we've had three who came back and an arbitration. So that suggests to me, my reading, that once you reach a settlement in an investor state case, the likelihood of compliance is high. And so I think that, and if you then know that you could go to enforcement mechanism if you need it under Singapore, then that would be helpful. I hope that that helped clarify my thoughts on that issue.
Yes, I think that was very clear. So unfortunately, I think our time has run out. So on behalf of ICSID, I would like to thank our co-host, the Investment Treaty Arbitration Committee of the Japan Association of Arbitrators, and specifically Mr. Hiroyuki Tezuka and Mr. Lars Marquardt for their organizing the event and also their kind introductions. I'd also like to thank my esteemed colleague Frauke Nitschke for sharing her knowledge, and our audience for your participation and your questions. And we hope to collaborate on many more programs in the future. And as you heard from Frauke, we'll be coming back in, I guess, the spring for more mediation training.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody.
Great. Thank you. Bye.